Now, many of Emmanuel Velikovsky's celestial theories can be verified by many of the ancient Egyptian myths or mythos texts and stories, and also supports the evidence of Moses and Musa's, his version of the creation or the Fitrat. There's a short quote that's found in one of the 12th dynasty Egyptian literature called Shipwreck Sailor that mentions that a, quote, star hit the earth, end quote. And this is thought to refer to the Exodus and the Passover event, or the event horizon of the Passover, the Cow Comet, the destroyer that passed over at this time. Now, what's interesting that we find is when we look at, let's see if we can bring this up right here. We look at, here we have the Book of Enoch or Hanok, and this is the 85th chapter. Now, we have mentioned this before, and we'll mention this again here, that in the older, the Gittes text, especially the Gittes text of Metzhafe Hanok, it uses a lot of verbal hieroglyphics. Like here in the chapters before, it speaks, for example, let's just go to chapter 84, where it says, after this, I saw another dream and explained it all to you, my son. Enoch arose and said to his son Methuselah, to you, my son, will I speak. Hear my word and incline your ear to the visionary dream of your father. Before I married your mother, Edna, I saw a vision on my bed. And behold, look and see, verse 2, a cow sprung forth from the earth, and this cow was white. Afterward, a female heifer sprung forth, and it with it another heifer, that's a female. One of them was black, and one was red. The black heifer struck the red one and pursued it over the earth. From that period, I could see nothing more of the red heifer, but the black one increased in bulk, and a female heifer came with him. After this, I saw that many cows proceeded forth, resembling him, and following after him. Now, the footnote down here tells us that this second vision of Hanok seems to portray in symbolic language or verbal hieroglyphs the complete story of the world from the time of Adam down to the final judgment and the establishment of the messianic kingdom. The B footnote says another heifer, mentions another heifer. The sense seems to require that the passage should read two other heifers. Then C, you can see it down here, C right here, it says Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel, so that's now being interpreted. So in the later Ethiopian and Amharic translations from the Ethiopic or the Gittes, instead of the cows as symbols, we have the so-called revelation of who these cows were. But now, one of the oldest books that we know is actually the Book of Enoch. Enoch perhaps would be in its proper order the oldest. We're not saying that every translation or every scribal rewriting of it, but the contents of it presents the oldest. And we can see the language. Throughout this, we can see the language that's used of the cows, of the heifers, of the bulls, so forth and so on. Now, the link here with the shipwrecked sailor and the star that hit the earth, we find in chapter 85 of the Book of Enoch, where it says, again, I looked attentively while sleeping and surveyed heaven above, and behold, a single star fell from heaven. So now what we have here, right here, is that he saw a single star fall from heaven, which being raised up, ate and fed among the cows. And after that, I perceived other large and black cows. And behold, all of them changed their stalls and pastures, while the young began to lament one with another. Again, I looked in my vision and surveyed heaven, and behold, I saw many stars descend. So there was one single star that fell, and then afterward there were many stars that descended and projected themselves from heaven. This word is interesting in the translation, projected themselves from heaven to where the first star was, into the midst of those young ones, while the cows were with them feeding in the midst of them. And I looked at and observed them, and behold, they all acted after the manner of horses and began to approach the young cows. So again, horses, we have this symbolic language being used, metaphorical language. All of them became pregnant and brought forth elephants, camels, and asses. So you can see clearly in this oldest of the scriptures, especially the Hebrew scriptures and the Ethiopic, the book of Enoch, that in Enoch's time, which is in the early chapters of the Bible, which projects it to the early period of this age or cycle, that they were using symbolical language in speaking. Now, some say that Enoch is actually Tehuti or Thoth. He's actually Thoth. And some say that Thoth was one of the survivors from the Atlantean so-called disaster, so forth and so on. But the link with the fact that the Egyptians were not the only ones that used animals and symbolic language to describe deeper events which must be interpreted. But just two more verses to complete this chapter, 7 and 8. At these all, the cows were alarmed and terrified when they began biting with their teeth, swallowing and striking with their horns. They began also to devour the cows, and behold, all the children of the earth trembled, shook with terror at them, and suddenly fled away. So two points we want to make right here. One is the use of symbolic language in the earliest writings of the Bible, like the Metzhafer Henoch or the Book of Enoch, which demonstrates that this early time, like in Egypt and like in other cultures, they use symbolism to describe multi-layer meanings. And then also in chapter 85, verse 2, about the single star that fell from heaven. Now, whether this is something like a Nibiru incident or not, we'll have to, you know, research that and document it a little bit further. But what all this basically supports as well is Velikovsky's speculation. And it gives a date or a time, a possible date. They say the 12th dynasty. But remember, from the 12th or the 13th, the 12th to the 18th dynasty is one of the most confusing periods in Egyptian chronology, because it's almost as though they went through five dynasties like that. Like it's one of the most confusing periods. This is when some say the Hyksos or the Hyksos invasion, so forth and so on. Some of us date the Exodus more to the 18th dynasty, after the so-called native restoration of ancient Egypt. But it's interesting, this period of the 12th dynasty, we more point to that period, the 12th dynasty, more of Yosef's time. And within that 400 or so period of years, we have from the 12th to the 18th dynasty and to the Exodus under the Thutmose seeds, the Tehut Muses. This now quote that we just gave from the shipwrecked sailor may also refer to, according to Velikovsky's theory, the king who was felled or slain at the time. And some say this was Menemhet the first. However, it may refer to both a simultaneous celestial and earthly event. Not only was a king killed, but a star hit or punished the earth for sins. So that's another connection that we can explore. So when we're looking at this period of the Exodus, and we're looking at the scriptures, and we're looking at these chapters, and we begin to study some of the details, we begin to really recognize that the only way for us to put these matters into their proper historical context is to refer to the accurate context of the time. And for us, with the Bible and with the scriptures, that, of course, no doubt, would be ancient Egypt. So in order for us to put these things into its proper context and to have the most accurate interpretive value out of all that we are able to reconstruct or to come across, it's very important for us to utilize that particular study method. So give thanks and praise to His Majesty in the name of Jesus Christos, and more to come. Stay tuned. Shalom Rastafari.